Howdy, Mother Factors, and welcome to this wonderful, super full, and, Batman full edition of 101 Facts. I'm Sam, and I'm here to talk to you today about a titan in the world of comics and entertainment that has brought us some of the greatest superheroes ever, along with a little bit of justice and, suicide to boot. That's right, I'm talking DC Comics. But what's with their obsession with gorillas? What's the difference between all the worlds in the DC multiverse? How much money do I need to pay for an MCU-DC crossover movie to happen? I know it will be a complete narrative mess of a film, but I still really want to see it. 2 out of 3 of those questions are going to be answered, so get yourself to the JLA Watchtower and prepare to read panels upon panels upon panels chock full of justice. Just watch out for paper cuts. This is 101 Facts about DC. Number 1. In case you thought this was about the last half of Washington, or about Dane Cook, but just referring to him by his street name, it ain't. DC refers to DC Comics, which was officially founded in 1934. Number 2. DC is the stable of some of the most popular characters in the world, including Superman, Wonder Woman, Batman, Flash, Green Lantern, Green Arrow, and Armful Off Boy. Wait, he's not one of the most popular ones? Oh, he really should be. Number 3. It's also printed some great stuff that's more mature and for bigger boys, set outside the DC universe, well, until very recently anyway. This includes V for Vendetta, Watchmen, and Preacher. Number 4. It wasn't always known as DC though, folks. Nope. In the early days, the company's name was National Allied Publications, which was founded by a man named Malcolm Wheeler Nicholson. Number 5. Their first comic, New Fun, was printed in 1935 and was the first comic to print on original material, not reprints of strips from old newspapers. So, you know, anti-recycling in other words. Who needs recycling anyway? That's a joke, we all do, okay? We all need recycling. Number 6. Because he was in need of some dollar-dollar bills, yo, Nicholson partnered with magazine distributors Harry Donenfield and Jack Leibowitz and founded Detective Comics Inc. in 1937. Number 7. Nicholson, however, was unable to pay back his debts, and so was forced out of the company in quite possibly the rudest way imaginable. Nicholson and his wife were sent on holiday, which actually sounds quite nice, but wait, no it wasn't, because as they came back, Nicholson found that his office door locks had been changed and that he was being sued by Donenfield and Leibowitz. Number 8. There were many mergers in the 1940s leading to several renames of the company, including the, snappy name National Periodical Publications and National Comics. Number 9. After that, in around 1940, they began branding themselves as Superman DC. Ah, Superman, always coming in and naming things after himself, just because he can fly and stuff and he's all muscular. Yeah, okay, I'm jealous. I'll say it. Okay, I'm jealous of Superman. Happy now? Number 10. DC Comics did eventually stick and was used for many years until it was finally made official in 1977, making the name officially Detective Comics Comics. No, wait, that can't be right. Detective Comics Comics? That's so weird, it's like saying KFC Chicken or SNOOPDOG Dog. Well, I think. Number 11! Anyway, we have Jeanette Kahn to thank as she made the call to officially call DC Comics, DC Comics. Kahn joined DC in 1976 and was made president 5 years later. Kahn has been called the First Lady of Comics, as she is the reason why we have so many of the great comics we have today. Thanks, Jeanette. I salute you. Number 12. Speaking of soups, the first Superman comic was published in 1938 in the comic book Action Comic No. 1. With its huge commercial success in tight spandex, the comic defined the costume superhero genre we have today. That comic is probably worth a bucket load of dosh. Number 13. After this big red and blue super dollop of success, DC introduced superheroes such as Batman in 1939 and Wonder Woman in 1941. And so began the golden age of DC. Number 14. Many of the comics were used as World War II propaganda to boost support and morale for the war. They even shipped comics to soldiers to give them a top-up of motivation. Number 15. Many Superman comics had covers that were very Superman versus the Nazis, but it was actually quite rare for this to be the contents of the issue. This is probably because people wanted a bit of escapism from the whole war and death thing, and I for one can't blame them, it sounds horrible. Number 16. Once the war was over, however, and Nazi bottom had been kicked, and long may that be the case, by the way, DC Comics faced a little bit of a slump in sales overall. I know, Batman, I know, I'm sad about it too. Don't be too down about it though, because... Number 17. Popularity remained high for Superman, Batman, and Wonder Woman, the so-called Holy Trinity of DC Comics. So they cancelled other superhero titles and focused instead on them, sci-fi, and westerns instead. Number 18. Under the editor Julius Schwartz, DC began reintroducing superheroes again in the 1950s. In Showcase number 4 in October of 1956, writer Robert Kaniger and artist Carmine Infantino unveiled an updated version of the 1940s-era hero, The Flash, with a different suit and everything. Number 19. This was the flashpoint, flashpoint, of the Silver Age of comics, which was a run of comics that included revamped characters such as Green Lantern and the Justice League of America, who will be chatted about in just a little while, I promise. Number 20. Actually, F it, I'll just mention them now. The Justice League was originally called the Justice Society of America. They gained their league in the 1960s, inspired by the popularity of baseball leagues, apparently, along with some new members. Number 21. The original founding members of the Justice Society of America were the Atom, the Jay Garrick-flavoured Flash, the Spectre, Green Lantern, Hawkman, Dr. Fate, Sandman, and Hourman. Yep, all those big hitters. Number 22! The Justice Society of America was a big first in the world of comics, as it was the first intercompany mashup crossover title. At that time, Atom, Flash, Green Lantern, and Hawkman were published by All American Publications and not DC. Number 23. In fact, the Justice League is the main reason why Marvel has the Fantastic Four. When Marvel saw how well they were doing with their supergroup, they decided to whip one up of their own. Number 24. Another couple of branches of comics called Vertigo DC Comics are more adult in nature, including the aforementioned Watchmen and Preacher, which has since been turned into a TV series by Seth Rogen. Number 25. 25 backwards is 52, which reminds me that I should probably talk about the new 52. This happens after the 2011 story Flashpoint, in which, for various reasons, the universes of the mainstream DC universe and the Vertigo universe are unified and their timeline is reset. Number 26. Afterwards, DC used this event as an opportunity to relaunch and rewrite a lot of storylines in the DC universe. In fact, they relaunched 52, yep, see where they got the name, DC properties, in November of 2011. Number 27. For instance, in the New 52, Lois Lane and Supes never got together. I know, right? And his adoptive parents have died. Yeah, because that's what the DC Universe needs, more dead parents. Number 28. Batman, however, was largely unaffected by this change, with his stories A Death in the Family and The Killing Joke retaining their canonicity. What the hell is that? No, Clive, I said canonicity, not Canon City. Christ almighty. Do you want to go back in the cupboard? Number 29. The New 52 was developed because continuity and storylines in comics are unbelievably confusing. There were more unresolved threads in the comics than in a burnt-down fabric factory. That joke is very clever once you think about it. And new readers simply didn't know where to start reading from. Number 30. This is something that the DC Universe has actually done before and since, with stories such as Crisis on Infinite Earths and Convergence, which is actually the thing that drew the New 52 to an end. Number 31. Although Superman is one of the most well-known superheroes in the world, it's Batman that holds the title for most appearances, which currently stands at over 6,250 comic appearances. Holy popularity, Batman! Number 32. But let's not focus on them for the time being, because we know all about them. Let's instead focus on a lost DC treasure, and surely the DCEU's, I'll talk about that later, next intellectual property. The hero Dog Welder. Dog Welder does exactly what you think he does, namely defeating bad guys by welding dead dogs to their faces. I could see him on kids' t-shirts now.
Number 33.
They also have the Hemogoblin, a supervillain vampire created by white supremacists to eliminate people of non-white ethnicity by spreading HIV and AIDS through biting them. Wow, imagine being in that meeting and saying that that was a good idea. Number 34. The character Danny the Street is a, actual street. Yes, that's right, Danny is a sentient road hero who can teleport anywhere. His flamboyant personality is based on real-life performer Danny LaRue, as is his name. He's appeared in the Doom Patrol and Teen Titan comics. Number 35. Batman actually once fought a villain made entirely of marijuana who was called the Floronic Man. A Batman villain? That would make more sense for Cyborg, right? Because then, when he's defeated, you could say he was Victor Stoned. Ah, yes, I'm more proud of that than I should be. Number 36. There is only one character in all of comic book fiction to be a member of both the Justice League and the Avengers, a fierce, brave, mighty hero, Hawkeye. Wait, Hawkeye? Seriously? No offense, Clint, but man, I really didn't think it would be you. Hawkeye very briefly becomes a member of the JLA in the JLA vs. Avengers crossover comic. Number 37. Speaking of utterly, utterly weird things that DC have done, the Joker once served as the Iranian ambassador to the United Nations. In this book, just after the Cold War, Joker meets Ayatollah Khomeini, who then decides to give him this position. Yep, just as weird as you thought. Number 38. Speak of the devil, the Joker is one of DC's biggest villains and one of the most celebrated of all time. He was inspired by Conrad Veidt as Gwynplaine in the movie The Man Who Laughs. Number 39. He's a villain of some decorum, at least. Well, sometimes. In the 1997 comic Batman / Captain America, Elseworlds, the Joker was hired by Marvel's Red Skull to steal an atomic bomb during World War II. So far, so villainous. He steals it successfully, but then is horrified to learn that the Red Skull is a Nazi. He shouts, "I may be a criminal lunatic, but I'm an American criminal lunatic." Ha ha! Oh god, sorry, that was awful. I'm sick to the day job. Number 40. It's not just the Batman that Joker irks, though. Oh no, sirree. In the Injustice Gods Among Us game and spin-off comic series, Joker bombs Metropolis, including Lois Lane and Superman's unborn child. Superman reacts quite reasonably to this by ripping out the Joker's heart before starting a totalitarian regime. Oh boy. To be fair, if he goes anywhere near Jennifer Lawrence, he's at least getting a poke in the eye from me. Number 41. Speaking of Joker, his missus, Harley Quinn, debuted in the 90s Batman animated series. Because of her popularity in that series, she was introduced to the comic book universe.
The meaning of life.
Speaking of the Joker's other missus, Prince, oh no, sorry, that's just my fanfiction. DC once made a comic about Prince battling an evil ex-bandmate called Gemini. This was loosely based on the Bat Dance music video, which he wrote for the 1989 Batman movie. Number 43. In the Teen Titan Annual, it claims that John F. Kennedy was actually an alien imposter. Oh, you might want to get on this all-time conspiracies. Well, the one that was assassinated was an imposter anyway. The real JFK, apparently, went into space to overthrow an evil alien government. Number 44. If you're confused by the whole multiverse thing with DC, here's a map to help you out. As you can see, the multiverse includes Dreamland, Nightmare, Hell, and Heaven. Oh man, Belinda Carlisle must be so disappointed. Number 45. The different Earths can vary in many different ways. Earth 23, for example, is inhabited by many black versions of DC characters. This Earth's Superman is based on Barack Obama, and Wonder Woman was based on Beyoncé Knowles, according to Grant Morrison. Number 46. Earth 44 contains the Metal League, with an all-robotic Justice League lineup. I'm not quite sure how Aquaman bot functions, to be honest. Surely he'd fry up every time he has to go home. Number 47. Ah yes, Aquaman. Aquaman is a much joked about superhero and part-time octopus doctor, but he is in fact one of the most powerful heroes in the DC universe. He has super strength and can control aquatic creatures, i.e. he could make Sharknado happen. Yeah, think of that before you laugh at Arthur Curry. Number 48. In the game Injustice 2, for instance, Aquaman can do this to you. Yeah, still laughing about Arthur Curry now, are we, Number 49. Even though he was supposed to be a lone alien, Superman has many Kryptonian mates, such as Supergirl, Superboy, and Crypto the Super Dog, who hopefully stays well away from Dog Welder, because I can't imagine that ending well. Number 50. The Super Friends was a hit Hanna-Barbera kids cartoon in the 70s that was based around the Justice League. Aww, Super Friends. See, Zack Snyder should take a leaf out of this book. Number 51. There have been many other DC superhero TV shows over the years, including three Superman shows, the Wonder Woman 70s show starring the wonderful Linda Carter, and the wacky 60s Batman show starring Adam West, which holds a special place in my heart. The New 52. The Black Bomber was originally going to be DC's first black superhero. The Bomber was originally a white racist who would turn into a black man when he was stressed. Yep, by the way, this actually nearly happened. The character was, for obvious reasons, very controversial, and was described by comics historian Don Markstein as an insult to practically everyone with any point of view at all. Which is a sick burn, bro. Number 53. In order to salvage the character, comic book writer Tony Isabella, who had worked on Marvel's Luke Cage, made him into Black Lightning, a much more badass and, frankly, less offensive character. Number 54. Lex Luthor, another one of the most famous villains of all time, is the archenemy of Superman. Villain. That being said, though, he did actually join the Justice League with his big green and purple supersuit, so he can't be all bad, right? Right? Nah, he's still bad. Number 55. Batcow is a thing that exists in the DC Universe. Yes, I know, I didn't believe it too. She came into fruition after Batman and Robin took the cow to test it for diseases. It was Robin, by the way, who christened it with its frankly great name. Number 56. Comic Sans, you know, this wonderful font that will guarantee you any job interview, was based on the lettering that was used for The Dark Knight Returns and Watchmen. So two very dark things influence your homework as a kid, and maybe your resume. Who'd have thunk it? Number 57. Beyond the comics, as you may already know, DC has had many films. In fact, there are over 32 live-action films based on the comics, including Halle Berry in Catwoman and the Dark Knight trilogy. Number 58. Their most recent output, as of late, is set in the same cinematic universe, known as the DCEU, the DC Extended Universe. This allows the characters to interact comic book style, you know, conversing with each other, romancing each other, beating the crap out of each other, and plus, seemingly everyone gets their own movie. Yay! Number 59. One such hero with an upcoming movie film, as of time of current babbling, is Diana Prince, aka Wonder Woman. She was first introduced to the DC Universe in All-Star Comic 8 in December of 1941. Number 60. William Moulton Marston created Wonder Woman, but he also created something else. He helped invent lie detectors by noticing a link between blood pressure and emotion. Also, one of Wonder Woman's prized possessions is her lasso of truth. A link there, perhaps. Maybe. Number 61. Wonder Woman also featured on the first Ms. Magazine, a feminist left-wing magazine that was published in 1972. But for more about her, why not wait until about May on this channel? Hashtag tease. Number 62. As for the Batman, he was created by artist Bob Kane and writer Bill Finger all the way back in 1939. Number 63. I am sure you don't need me to go into the Caped Crusader's origins again. In fact, I did a whole video on the Bat, so I shan't talk about him all that much further. But his origin story was first in Detective Comics 33 and was later fleshed out in Batman 47. Nintendo 64. The Justice League first appeared in The Brave and the Bold number 28 in 1955. The assembly of the team was put together by Gardner Fox, a writer who co-created The Flash. Number 65. The Justice League is just one of many teams within the DC Universe. For instance, there's also the Suicide Squad, the Teen Titans, the Green Lantern Corps, and the Legion of Superpets. Number 66. They're an intergalactic police force. Oh, no, sorry, the Green Lantern Corps, I mean, not the Legion of Superpets. There's more than 7,200 of them too, so you better watch out if you're being extra space naughty. Number 67. Superman is just about the best at everything, right? Wrong. When it comes to speed, the Flash is just about faster than the Man of Steel. Number 68. However, when it comes to the whole Justice League, Batman could defeat all of them, technically. In the Tower of Babel Justice League storyline, Batman's secret files that outline how to defeat them are all stolen. And people are not happy about it. Yeah, understandably. Point is, though, that Batman knows everybody's weaknesses and can exploit them. So don't cross Batman.
Number 69. Oh, matron.
This includes using Scarecrow's fear toxin to render Aquaman aquaphobic, i.e. scared of water, making Wonder Woman die of exhaustion by tricking her into fighting a virtual reality version of herself, and blinding Green Lantern, which is quite harsh, really. Number 70. Flash is so fast, in fact, that he could turn back time. And change reality, as we see in the Flashpoint Paradox. He also once ran so fast he melted himself, as seen in the Crisis of Infinite Earths. I felt like I was doing that once, but I was actually going on level 3 on the treadmill. Don't laugh, it's difficult. Number 71. Flash actually got his very own TV show, spun off from Green Arrow's TV show, Arrow. And here's where things get a tad confusing. The DCEU is separate from the Arrowverse on TV, but the DCEU has its own Flash played by Ezra Miller. So there's two Flashes and quite a few different worlds when you consider Gotham too. Looks like we could be headed for a crisis. Numberdy 72. Numberdy? What? If there is a crisis, let's hope beyond hope that this guy is there. This is Matter Eater Lad, a hero who can, eat and digest all matter. Yep, I reckon he could definitely take Darkseid down on his own. Number 73. There's actually a French spoof of Superman named Super Dupont, published by French magazine Pilote in 1972. He has a sidekick rooster named Gallic. Eat that, Clark Kent. Eat that. Number 74. Batman is known as the world's greatest detective, but the other greatest detective in the world, Sherlock Holmes, is a character within the DC Universe. I know, there's a crossover you didn't see happening. Batman is, understandably, a big fan of his. That's strange, I'd put him more down as an Inspector Morse man.
You wearing any pants?
No.
Okay.
I feel often of a Superman. There are many villains that are the reverse or bizarro versions of the DC characters, including, well, Bizarro, who sounds like the world's worst stripper, who is actually Superman's odd doppelganger, along with his powers too. There's also a Bat-Zaro, as well as the Reverse Flash. They love mirror images over there, don't they?
Siri, say 76.
That may be beyond my abilities at the moment.
What? Well then, number 76. Nubica, or NBC as it's known, is bringing us a TV show all about unpowered people in the DCEU called Powerless. Specifically, it's set at Wayne Enterprises, starring Abed from Community and Gabriella from High School Musical. Nice to know they're breaking free of their own roles, do you see what I did there? Number 77. For years, Dwayne The Rock Johnson has been attached to the Shazam film playing the lead hero, Shazam, more on them later. Instead, though, he is playing the villain Black Adam. The reason he made this decision was because villains are like onions and have more layers. Although he didn't say the onion bit, that was just straight out of Shrek for you. Number 78. Comics Watchmen, The Killing Joke and The Dark Knight Strikes Again were all almost banned from various states and even libraries because of their violent content. Too edgy for me. Number 79. Superman is the company's greatest asset, so they would do anything to crack down on his competition, especially in the early days. In 1939, for instance, DC stopped Fox Publications from publishing their Wonder Man comics, claiming the character was too similar to Superman. Number 80. DC won the case after Will Eisner, Wonder Man's writer, testified in court that he had been instructed to copy Superman specifically. The company lost $3,000, which doesn't sound like much, no, but it was a lot back then. In fact, it is now, really. If you have, you know, $3,000 hanging around spare, I could do with it. Number 81. DC similarly did this again against Fawcett Comics and their character Captain Marvel. I know, very confusing. Captain Marvel, Marvel, DC. Blah, blah. DC initially sued Fawcett for Marvel being too similar to Superman, but lost in the first case, but won the appeal. Number 82. DC then went on to inherit the characters of Fawcett, but Captain Marvel did not appear for a long, long time. Eventually, he did again in the 1960s, but rebranded as Shazam because Marvel, you know, Marvel Comics, had trademarked the word Marvel. Oh, this is all very complicated, isn't it? Number 83. In case you weren't aware, Billy Batson is a child who was given his powers from an old wizard named Shazam. Whenever he said, Shazam, he would become the adult Captain Marvel, the pretty buff Captain Marvel, actually. It was a very big success. It even had its own TV show. Number 84. Bob Kane, creator of Batman, was ready to kill off the Joker in his very first appearance. However, Batman's editor, Whitney Ellsworth, saw potential in the character, and thankfully he was saved. Phew! Think of the sales of white face makeup plummeting if that had happened. Number 85. There's a village called Gotham just outside Nottingham in the UK. Just thought you lot ought to know that.
Gotham City.
Number 86. A lot of DC comics feature gorillas on their covers. After publishing Strange Adventures 8 in 1951, which had a gorilla on its front, they noticed that it achieved some sort of cult status. They would then repeat this pattern about once a month because apparently gorillas equal sales. Wow, maybe I should have had a gorilla in the thumbnail for this video. Number 87. In fact, one of Flash's enemies is actually a guy called Gorilla Grodd, a resident of Gorilla City, which is home to a race of super intelligent gorillas. Yep, DC loves gorillas. Number 88. Batman was not always the Dark Knight.
What?
He was actually quite bright once upon a time. When he was first being designed, the bat's costume was a deep red with a bright yellow belt. Oh, get you, looks lovely. Number 89. Scientist and all-round cool man Neil deGrasse Tyson appeared in 2012's Action Comics Volume 2 Number 14, putting the Man of Steel's home planet Krypton on the solar system map. In fact, Tyson actually met up with the writers during production so that they could track together exactly where Krypton would be in our solar system. Number 90? Goodness, wow! Marvel head honcho and cameo genius Stan Lee has actually written a fair few DC comics in his time too. In the Just Imagine series, Lee writes alternative storylines for some of our favourite heroes like Bats and The Flash. Number 91. In this series, Robin is actually a bad guy working for a bad dude named Reverend Dark. He's obsessively trying to kill Batman too. Oh, Stan Lee, you've wrecked that relationship up, eh? Number 92. I'm sure you think the S on Superman's costume stands for his name, and in the beginning it was. But in the Christopher Reeve film Superman the Movie, it's revealed that the symbol is actually the coat of arms for the House of El. Also, in the 2013 movie Man of Steel, he tells Lois that it stands for Hope, which is very weird because Hope stands for H, not an S, so that would make it Shope, which is weird. Number 93. Speaking of Hope and Superman, Superman once lost a boxing match to the legendary Muhammad Ali, somehow. In fact, Ali left him on a stretcher. I mean, he must have broken his fist in the process, though. He's like, he's literally a Man of Steel. Or almost literally, anyway. That's the name they give him. Anyway, let's move on. Number 94. Just in case you thought their Martha complex wasn't enough, Superman and Batman's dads have actually met each other. In Superman Batman 50, Thomas Wayne comes across Kryptonian technology and meets Jor-El. They have a discussion about Earth, and Thomas takes the technology to use it for Wayne Enterprises. This also leads to the revelation that most of Batman's gear is made with the same Kryptonian tech as Supes' stuff. Number 95! You may have heard the term Brainiac and may know that there's a DC villain also called Brainiac, but did you know the villain came first? Yes, that's right, the villain's first appearance predates the term's usage, meaning that we all got it from him and he got it from his mama. Number 96. The University of Victoria has a Science of Batman course which allows you to study the limitations of the human mind and body, as well as probably some masks and tight pants too. Probably, if you're into that kind of thing. I got my tight pants on. Number 97. Technically, Superman works for Batman. You want proof? Well, Wayne Enterprises owns the Daily Planet, where Superman's alter ego Clark Kent works, so Bruce could technically fire him. Just imagine the water cooler banter. Number 98. Marvel and DC have crossed over before, most recently in the JLA Avengers comic, where they essentially swapped universes for a little while to collect 12 immense MacGuffins, I mean, items, of immense power. Number 99. There's also the Amalgam Universe, which I've mentioned at least 1,000 times on 101 Facts by now, where mashups of Marvel and DC characters exist, including Super Soldier, Superman and Captain America, Dark Claw, Batman and Wolverine, and Amazon, Storm and Wonder Woman.
Number 100!
There's also Lego forms of these characters who appear in the Lego Cinematic Universe. Batman, star of his own movie these days, which is, by the way, excellent, is voiced by Will Arnett. Superman is voiced by Channing Tatum. Green Lantern is voiced by Jonah Hill.
You want to sit together at the meeting?
I have to go back to Krypton.
And Wonder Woman is Cobie Smulders.
Number 101!
If you think Deadpool is a bad good guy or anti-hero, wait till you get a load of Lobo, a gritty intergalactic biker who committed genocide against his whole race. Why, you ask? For fun. Yep, that's right. Can't wait for a PG-13 or 12A movie about him. I'll just wait right here, Zack Snyder and Jeff Johns. Anyway, it feels the right time for an M-board now, doesn't it? Here we go.